Hey everyone, good morning. This is Pastor Peter again. I wanted to talk a little bit today about the question of why am I a Christian? And I want to answer a question that is more than just why did I become a Christian, but more specifically, why am I still a Christian right now, even after two decades of being a Christian? Because there's always time to leave Christianity, right? Regardless of what philosophy or worldview you hold on to, there's always opportunity for you to exercise your free will and decide to go another direction. So, for example, there are a lot of people who are atheists or agnostics who become a Christian later in life, and there are a lot of Christians who decide to become atheist or switch religions and become a Buddhist. And so, what is the reason why, ever since the late 80s, I have become a Christian and have maintained, and not only maintained, but also grew in my faith, even though there were many opportunities to doubt and question my faith, regardless of whether I was a pastor or when I wasn't a pastor. I would say actually there were more opportunities to doubt Christianity when I was a pastor. Now, some of you may be surprised at that, but think about it this way. When you're a pastor, you get to see all of the politics and the ugliness in Christendom, in the church, the place where it's supposed to be the most holy, and you realize that not everything is heavenly inside the political atmosphere of your own small little church leadership and the church congregation. There's a lot of strife in the church. There's a lot of power plays in the church. Not everyone cares about being Christ-like or growing spiritually. People are there at church. Even the church members, even long-term church members, have certain motives for the reason why they're there, and it's not always pure. And there are many opportunities to doubt the veracity of the Christian faith just by looking at the lifestyle of certain Christians that are supposed leaders. And let alone that, but also academic and intellectual questions that arise from time to time, either when you're reading through the scriptures or wondering about why God isn't answering certain prayers, or even from congregants when they ask you questions in your Sunday school class, or even passing by when you just talk to them and they have a crisis of faith. And it causes you as a pastor to also think about, well, how would I answer that question? Because I never thought of it that before. And you're both thankful, but also wondering at the same time, that congregant asked you that question, but also you're thankful for that, but also you're also curious of, wait, you know, that's a good question. You know, how would I answer that question? And does that challenge my faith to the point where I should think about reevaluating it or even switching it? Anyways, the main reason why I've stuck to being a Christian, outside of, I believe, the Holy Spirit guiding me and sustaining me, because I believe once saved, always saved, right? I believe that the scriptures teach that. And I believe that anyone who's truly genuinely saved who leaves the faith is only doing so temporarily, and they're going through some sort of a Luke chapter 15 prodigal son experience. But outside of that, okay, outside of the Holy Spirit sustaining me, what are the main reasons why I have stayed in the faith? Why I have not decided to become an atheist, agnostic, a Buddhist, or some other religion? Well, a couple of main reasons. Number one, and I would say probably the most strongest reason for why I stay in the faith is because there's just too much evidence for it, from my point of view. There's too much evidence for Christianity being true. And number two, because of life changes that have happened in my life as a result of becoming a Christian. And I would say number three, miracles and seeing supernatural things that happen in other people's lives and also in my life. And it's very hard for me to believe that those were caused naturalistically or just by chance rather than by something that was and is supernatural. So the first one, I mean, it's rather obvious. And although some of you may think that, well, why are you talking about evidence and truth when it comes to religion? I think there's a misnomer. A lot of people think that religion should be a faith and it shouldn't be based on truth, but it should be based on your feelings. But honestly, if you take an honest evaluation of that, why would you base anything that you believe in on just feelings if there's no good reason to believe in it? And regardless of whether you're a Christian, whether you're a Muslim, whether you're a Buddhist, whether you're an atheist or agnostic, there's a reason why you're that way. And even if you're not willing to admit this, one of the big reasons of why you believe what you believe or you have the philosophy that you have is because you believe that there's more reason to trust or believe that whatever philosophy or worldview that you hold to is real over and against the idea that it might not be real. All right? To put it in mathematical terms, you probably believe that there's more than a 50% chance that your atheism is more true than the fact that there is a God. Okay? And for me, I believe that there's a 90% chance that Christianity is true over a 10% chance that it's not true, which is why I believe in Christianity and why I've stayed a Christian, beyond, of course, the Holy Spirit sustaining me. And specifically, the top evidences that I find that are very convincing to me is, number one, the evidence that a creator God exists. There's just too much evidence that God exists. And the reasons of why God wouldn't exist the evidences that atheists that I know and I've read told me why God wouldn't exist actually aren't really reasons why God wouldn't exist. If you think about it, most of the atheists and agnostics' criticism of God has nothing to do with their existence. It has more to do with their character, meaning that they don't like the type of God that they see from the Bible. So, for example, Dawkins calls God a moral monster, right? He can't understand why God would call for the judgment against all of the Canaanites for them to be slaughtered by the Israelites, or the global flood judging the entire world except for one family, one small family, for their sins. But think about it this way. That really isn't an argument against the existence of God. It's an argument against the kind of God that is portrayed in the Bible. It doesn't really say anything against the idea that God exists. They just don't like the type of God that is portrayed from the Bible. That's it. So they've really done nothing, at least for me, to convince me that God doesn't exist. Then there's the usual argument from evil. Well, how can a good God exist and a powerful, all-powerful God exist if evil also exists? That means that he's probably not as powerful or as good as you thought. Again, if you noticed, logically, that doesn't do anything against the existence of God. What it does, it might impugn upon some of the traditional nature of what kind of God we believe in. Maybe he is good, but not as good as we thought. Or maybe he is all-powerful, but just not as all-powerful as we thought. By the way, I think that he can be all-powerful and all-good, but yet allow for the existence of evil in the world. But regardless, even if you give them that point, that argument, it doesn't negate the existence of God. What it does is that it calls into question God's character, who God is. But that's it. Okay, and so as a result of that, and as a result of all the positive evidences for God, for example, evidence from the design that we see in the universe, the evidence from first cause, that there had to be a cause to the beginning of the universe, evidence from the fact that there seems to be so many things that were already there, laws and rules in the universe, again, related to design, before that could not have evolved. For example, the idea of numbers that exist in the universe, natural laws, physical laws. There's not a lot of explanatory power by use of evolution to explain why all of these orderly laws and mathematical principles existed right at the start of the universe that were not evolved, and it didn't seem to come by chance. And where there is information and order, it sort of speaks to an information giver and an orderly, and someone who actually ordered the universe together. The moral argument is also another one. It's really hard to even believe that objective values and morals exist if there were no God, because if God doesn't exist, then morals are all arbitrary, and evil is just what we have decided to label as evil. There's really no true evil. It just is basically survival of the fittest. Anyways, the existence of God is just overwhelming, in my opinion, the evidence for it. And then you have the evidence for Jesus. And that in itself is also, maybe I wouldn't say is as overwhelming as or as convincing as the existence of God, but it is very, very convincing to me. The fact that, number one, we have four different early texts, biographies that talk about Jesus, his life, death, and resurrection in various ways. And these four earliest documents are found in the first part of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Gospels, that we even have evidence of Jesus that predate even the Gospel of Mark, which is the earliest gospel. For example, 1 Corinthians, specifically 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 10, which is a tradition that goes all the way back to either 34 to 36 AD, just 1 to 5 years within Jesus's resurrection and ascension, that talk about Christ having died and having risen again for the salvation of the sins of humankind. And so you have all of this evidence for the existence not only of a human being named Jesus, but the fact that he was a very spiritual and even a divine being, someone who actually forgave people of their sins, did miracles, died on the cross for the forgiveness of sins, and rose from the dead, and people believed that he was God, all the way up to the point of his death and resurrection. I mean, the evidence is so close to his life when he actually lived that it's hard to believe that it was just made up or sort of a fairy tale that was added on. So, and not only that, but you have at least six different non-biblical sources, non-Christian sources that are Jewish, sources that are Greek, sources that are Roman, that also speak of not only his existence, but the fact that he did miracles, that his believers said that they saw him after he died on the cross. So basically the post-resurrection or post-mortem appearances, and that he would come back again after he ascended into heaven. I mean, there's just a lot of historic and manuscript evidence that are very close to the date of Christ, life and death and resurrection, that it's hard to dismiss that. And when you compare the manuscript evidence of how many manuscripts that we have that talk about the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, how early these pieces of evidence are compared to the date of the events that which it happened, and then when you compare that to other works of antiquity about biographies about other famous people, Julius Caesar or Alexander the Great, other people that we read in history, and you find out that there's more evidence and better evidence for the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, then that totally convinced me to believe more in what the Bible says about Jesus, because of the fact that if I am to believe what my history books say about a lot of these historical figures in the ancient world, then I'd have to believe in what they say about Jesus also, because there's greater evidence for Jesus. And so you have the evidence for the existence of God, then you have the evidence for Jesus being an actual person who existed in history and who seemed to have done the very things that the Bible says that he did, confirmed, of course, in the Bible itself and in non-biblical sources that were both for and against him. And then there's the third piece of evidence, which is the Bible itself, and how much evidence there is archaeologically for the Bible, and even hints of the idea that the Bible could be supernaturally inspired through the various prophecies that have been found to be true when you read history. For example, the fall of Babylon, or the fall of Tyre, the city of Tyre, or the prophecies concerning the Messiah and how they are fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And so a lot of these prophecies, which were written hundreds of years before these historic events actually happened, and how what was written about them actually came to be true, and it was written hundreds of years before, found in the Bible. I mean, that just sort of speaks to the supernatural characteristics of at least many parts of the Bible. And the fact that a lot of historians use the Bible to look to corroborate ancient history and also events of ancient history, because a lot of historians and archaeologists have found the Bible to be reliable in terms of names and places. I mean, that just pushes the veracity and the reliability of the Bible to a very high level for me. And so you have the existence of God, you have the evidence for Jesus, life, death, and resurrection, and then you have the reliability of the Bible. And all those three things put together, for me, what really convinced me of the truth of Christianity and has helped sustain my Christian faith throughout the years, even up until now. Now, again, that's just one category. Okay, the second category was how my life changed. Now, this you may have already known because I've shared this before in another vlog. Or if you know me, I've shared this before and just sharing my testimony. But so I won't belabor the point here. But basically, I used to be a very introverted guy, and I never wanted to talk about anything to anyone other than maybe video games. And that's it. But once I became a Christian, all of a sudden my personality exploded. It was like night and day. I wanted to talk about the Bible all the time. I had a conversion experience where all of a sudden all of my anger was taken away. I used to be very angry at many, many different people, family members, friends and strangers, cuss them out, everything. I would be a very introverted and brooding type of person. But when I became a Christian, all of a sudden, and I can only explain that it's because Jesus came into my heart and the Holy Spirit came in and changed me, I felt this joy and this erasing of the dissipation of a lot of the anger and the discouragement and the slight depression that I had during my early high school years. And it was replaced with joy and with a meaning in life, which was to know the Bible, to know God, and to make him known by sharing about Jesus and the Bible to others. And that's what I did. I mean, for those of you that knew me when I was younger, when I was in my teenage years, I would carry my New International Version Black Bible everywhere, even to restaurants, even to school, just in order for people to ask me, well, why are you holding your Bible there? I mean, I did that for evangelistic reasons, but also I did it because I was reading through the Bible. And so back then, remember, there was no smartphone or whatever that you can just click on Kindle or go online and just read it really quick. I mean, you had to bring hard copies or magazines with you to actually read material. And so I brought my Bible everywhere to read through it and also to use as an evangelistic tool, because people usually would be very curious, because not everyone, even Christians, would carry their Bible around to restaurants or to work or to your class and put it right or left of your classroom desk. I mean, so it radically changed my life and changed the course of my life, from changing me from a very introverted person to a very extroverted person when it came to spiritual things. Okay, so I saw that change in my life. A lot of people saw the change in my life too, and they're wondering what happened, right? And then when I shared with them, they either couldn't believe it, or they were surprised, or they're very glad that I was starting to go to church and I had become a Christian. And by the way, that was before I decided to go towards a pastoral path and felt that God was calling me towards becoming a pastor or a missionary. So some people will go, oh, it's because you wanted to train yourself in being a pastor or a missionary. That's why you acted like that. No, that's not the reason why. This is before I even thought of becoming a pastor or a missionary, before I even prayed and asked God, what is your calling for my life, for my future career, and for the life I should live. This was way before that. I had already had these changes and these desires, okay? So I would say it's because of these desires and this change in my life that I wanted to pursue the possibility of being a missionary or a pastor, not because I wanted to be a missionary pastor, and so therefore I did this to train myself, okay? I would say, although it wasn't as influential, but it still is one of the reasons why I am still a Christian, is because there's just too many miracles in the name of Jesus that are going on in my friend's life, in my life, and all around the world for me to doubt that God exists. I mean, or that Christianity is true. I mean, you have near-death experiences, which talk about out-of-body experiences, people going into the light and hearing the voice of God and hearing the voice of Jesus, or going actually to hell and getting a glimpse of hell and then coming back because they get resuscitated, then their soul returns to their body, and all of a sudden they become believers because they saw those things, the things that are mentioned in the Bible, that there actually is an afterlife, there actually is a heaven and a hell. To the personal miracles and the spiritual experiences that I've felt, answered prayer of a need that, for example, that we had for a college pastor back when I was a youth pastor in a church in Covina. And then 2 weeks later, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, even though he doesn't even know us and we have no contact with them, and even though we didn't advertise anywhere for this, the guy that basically fits what we were praying for shows up at our church and says that he's looking for a position as a college pastor or a college leader to help out with a college group, and he was wondering if we had that need. I mean, that's just one example of several answered prayers that I have experienced where we prayed for it and within a few weeks it happens. But stuff like that, okay, from my friends' lives and also from my own life, and just hearing missionaries share about crazy but true stories of healings and prophecies being answered, word of knowledge becoming true, like someone knowing something, like for example, me being here in Taiwan, this was actually shared with me that it would happen by a friend of mine who shared a word of knowledge with me, and she said, hey, I heard from God that you're going to Taiwan. Is this true? I heard you're moving to China. Is this true? And even though I had no contact with her and no one told her, and she didn't even talk to me or my circle of friends about our idea of moving there soon. And she basically shared, well, God told me this and he had a word for me for you. That's one of the reasons why we came here, because into Taiwan, because we felt that was God confirming our decision to move to Taiwan, which is a very, very big decision. Anyways, I mean, it's really hard to discount the supernatural when you experience these things. So you have all these supernatural things happening that I'm experiencing. Then you have my life change before I was a Christian to when I became a Christian. And then you have all of these evidences, the existence of God, the evidence for Jesus being who he actually said he was, or who people say that he was in the Bible, and the reliability of the Bible. I mean, all of that added together, it's a pretty good and I would say persevering and permanent case for why anyone can not only be a Christian, but be a lifetime Christian. And that's the reason or the reasons why I am still a Christian. And yes, I have read that classic work from Bertrand Russell, Why I Am Not a Christian. I read that when I was in college, and I found it to be quite weak as a reason for why not to be a Christian. I mean, he has some really good arguments in there, but most of his arguments talk about things that we as Christians would consider secondary, like talking about why are there so many different denominations. Well, I mean, that doesn't really take away the veracity of Christianity and what the Bible says, or what Jesus, the existence of Jesus and what he did on the cross. I mean, having different denominations, if anything, just shows that there's a variety of interpretations and expressions about who God is and what Jesus did. It doesn't take away from the fact that God actually existed and Jesus actually existed and did what he did. So we would consider a lot of what he shared in his great work as secondary arguments, or arguments against secondary characteristics of Christianity rather than against the primary core doctrines of the Christian faith. Anyways, that's why I am still a Christian, and I hope that this has encouraged those of you who are Christians and who might be doubting the faith to continue in the faith. If you have any questions, just ask underneath, and then I can talk to you either just in public on the comment section, or if you want to shoot me a note and we can talk more privately through email or whatnot. And if you're considering becoming a Christian, I hope you do. Okay, I hope you do, because as Jesus said, Christ is the way, truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. Hope you have a great day, everyone, and God bless. Bye-bye.